Okay, thank you. First of all, I would like to appreciate your punctuality in submitting your assignment. Good. Now, I think it's time for you to bring your work to class. So start with group one. Pierre, Arthur, and Gladys, okay, go ahead. Please present your answer for the first question, first assignment.
We should do a presentation on WhatsApp.
It's up to you. Send your answer or just talk about it. That's fine.
Well, in my group, we are using Gojek company.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, sir.
Okay. Sure.
The history behind Gojek is the thought of Nadiem.
No. I mean, I don't need to know the history. Just tell me, what's the main business of Gojek?
The main business of Gojek is GoRide. Gojek is mainly a service company.
Mm-hmm.
They are providing motorcycle taxi.
Mm-hmm.
So they want to support motorcycle taxi in Indonesia. So
mm-hmm.
they providing a platform for them.
Mm-hmm.
And in Gojek there are a lot of product, not only GoRide, but there are more than 20 program.
Okay. Anything else you want to add, Pia?
Gojek doesn't just provide main transportation, but also food and transportation delivery.
Okay.
At first, Gojek only have a few service, but now Gojek has more than 20 services.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But unfortunately, well, it's not your fault, I think. But unfortunately, your description about Gojek is a bit misleading, Gladys and Pierre. Gojek is not a transportation company. Gojek is a platform to connect between the customer and transportation provider. So the people who drive motorcycle, providing motorcycle taxi service, delivering food, products, is not actually Gojek. They just a business partner. That's why they called the driver is Mitra partner, not Gojek. Okay. So what happened? Gojek is providing a system, okay, for customer to find the nearest transportation provider, which is the driver. Okay, so I think the pure services provided by Gojek is not the Gojek itself. Okay, so you need to understand that, because otherwise, later on, when you documenting Gojek, you will describe the driver side or the customer side instead of Gojek side. Okay, you understand the difference, okay, Gladys and Pierre? Okay, good. So just for you to be clear, it's common misconception that Gojek providing transportation. No, Gojek's providing the system, the software, the application for driver to get order from customer and from for customer to find transportation provider. Okay, that's why Gojek has Bluebird inside it. Okay, because Bluebird provided taxi services. Okay, good. So you know now the main business or core business of Gojek. Okay, group two, Maria Putri Bintang and Vincentius Renault, please present your assignment.
Good morning, sir. Good morning,
good
and
morning.
Friends. We use Natasha Skincare.
Mm-hmm.
Natasha Skincare is the market's is shop of that sells various cosmetic products and other beauty products both in online and offline.
Mm-hmm.
They also do the promotion for online shopping in social media and their website.
Okay, good. Vincent, anything you want to add?
No, sir.
Okay,
good. All.
Okay, so, yes, Natasha, I've read your assignment in brief this morning, and yes, Natasha, in your case, provide selling. I think it's skincare product or something like that. Okay. But you need to be careful later because Natasha has a lot of other business as well, including the skincare services. Okay, so you need to separate that from the selling of beauty product or cosmetic that you already mentioned. Okay, good. Group three, Jessica, Natalia, and lovely Devina.
Hello, sir.
Okay.
Our group choose Secondit, and Secondit is a beauty company from Indonesia that launched mm-hmm. their first product on the 20th February 2020.
Mm-hmm. It's still young.
Yeah.
Okay.
The reason why we choose Secondit because it is so meaningful. Mm-hmm. Second date or the date number two is much more meaningful according to the cosmopolitan.com mm-hmm. than the first one because usually that's when couples start to learn and share about their interests, ideas and goals.
Okay.
It is believed that all those things can build, can knit people together. And therefore, mm-hmm. I think the co-founders of Second Date wanted their products to be as meaningful to buyers as on the second date that people usually do. And the
okay.
products of Second Date, there's like Milky Gelatine, like eyeshadow palette, scrunchies, hand sanitizer, and a sandy tea.
Well, it's very 2020, right? When companies sell name Second Date, sell products for the second date, and it include hand sanitizer.
Yes.
You know, before this pandemic, if somebody went on second date and they bring along hand sanitizer, it could be seen as an insult. Okay. But nowadays it's just the norm. Okay, thank you. Good. Group four, Faith Joshua and Eleonora Michelle, please present your assignment.
Okay. Good morning, sir, and
good morning.
Friends.
Good
morning, sir.
This group,
good morning.
My group is Observe, Netflix company.
Okay.
This company is provide streaming media services, and
mm-hmm.
they also provide offline and ongoing viewing, and they
okay.
also making original movies, series,
okay.
and TV show.
Okay, good.
Yes.
So you need to be clear about the just like the Gojek case that Netflix is providing the streaming services. Okay, so the content itself, the movie, the series, the TV show, sometimes, and well, it's not sometimes, a lot of them came from companies outside Netflix. So Netflix just put them on Netflix, and then whenever somebody streamed that, the owner of the content will get paid. Okay. So it's not really belong to me, except for Netflix as a producer that you already said original series. Okay, good. And last but not least, group 5, Jonathan and Hildegard.
Good morning, sir, and good morning, friends. Our group is observing about Tokopedia. Tokopedia is e-commerce in Indonesia. Indonesian technology company that specializing in e-commerce. And Tokopedia providing a marketplace that most diverse product in Indonesia. And then Tokopedia, the core business is marketplace, yeah, and product digital, new retail, and logistic and fulfillment that made easy shipping with an integrated logistic and fulfillment system.
Okay.
That's all from Group 5. Thank you.
Okay, but similar to Gojek and also Netflix, Tokopedia is not actually providing the word themselves or the product themselves, but they just providing an application or a system that enable seller to sell their products, buyer to buy that product, and when necessary, especially with the physical product, it will arrange for shipment, okay, or logistic that you said, Jonathan. But there's also another part of Tokopedia that provided, which is it's called the escrow account. In bahasa, you probably familiar with the term rekening bersama. So whenever you pay for your purchase, Tokopedia will help the money, and then after the seller deliver the product and you satisfied with the product that you receive, then Tokopedia will release the money to the seller. Okay, so that's it. Okay, so Tokopedia is providing marketplace, like, and also escrow account for transaction security. Because if you sell product online, especially like directly through Instagram, for example, or Facebook group or Facebook account or OLX, for example, nobody actually protect you from fraudulent people, okay? Especially when you cannot meet face to face and have direct transaction. That's where marketplace come in handy. You know, they will protect. I've been in the past, not that many, but a few times when I order something and the seller could not fulfill the order satisfactorily, Tokopedia just return my money. Okay, so that's good. Okay, so just to be clear about it. Okay, good. Thank you for everything that you already submitted and present. Okay, that's good. Now, today we will have this. Let me share. Okay. Let me know if you could not see the slides. Okay. So we will have today documenting business process and information system. Yeah, let's start. So what's documentation? So before I went to the data flow diagram, documentation is a written materials, either in hard copy or soft copy, that explaining or containing information about a system. Okay. Documentation came in few form, but the most used form are two. First is the narrative description. So you actually telling, describing the system, how it works, how it's being used, the strength and the weaknesses of systems, for example, how to use the system, user manuals, things like that, using written word. And the second tools that will be used is diagram. We will learn on how to draw diagram. There are data flow diagrams and also flowchart. Okay, now before we start, for diagramming, the most popular tools is a software called Microsoft Visio. Okay, this is the working space of Microsoft Visio. Our university subscribe to Microsoft Visio license. Unfortunately, the license number is limited, so it's only allowed for lecturers, and students could not use it. It's different from the Microsoft Office license that you can use it anytime you like, as long as you are a student here. So there are some few alternatives. Obviously, you can get a pirated version of Visio, which is a bad thing to do, or you can use a trial version of Visio, which is usually good for trial period, but then after that it's just a lot of pain to use that. Okay, so I already provide you with the link. This one. If you look at this, if you look at today's topic, I already provide you with two alternative to Visio, which is draw.io and DIA. Okay, so this is draw.io. The link is provided here. So this is a web-based diagram tools. You have to be connected to the internet and use web browser to use this. Okay, so it's similar to Visio, although it's not as advanced or as powerful as Visio, but for our courses, for this subject, it's sufficient. Okay, so when you click the link of this, not this one. Okay, let me close that. You will see this, okay, and this is where you will draw, okay, drawing the diagram. This is all the symbols. I'll explain to you later. Okay. The advantages of draw.io is you don't need to install anything into your computers, so it eliminates a lot of complexity. However, you need internet connection to use this. Okay, so if your internet service provider just happen to be interrupted, tough luck, you cannot use this. You can save the file. Okay, save as here into various, and you can as graphic, editable bitmap mix. I'll suggest when you save the file, you use this .png and insert that picture file into other software like Microsoft Word, for example. Okay. The second that alternative to Visio is, it's called DIA, the DIA editor. Okay, you need to download and install it, but it's also free. Okay, and it's similar to draw.io that I mentioned previously. It is you need to install it here. Okay, so there are this other screenshot that you can see the use of the IA here. Okay, so you can use it. Just download the that suitable for you know, for example, because I use Windows, then they provide me with it. But if you use Macintosh, for example, there is macOS and if you use Linux, there is Linux version. Okay, so you can use this also. Also have the see here. If you click home, there is this shapes that you can use, but unfortunately, shape is not as flexible and as easy as Dia or draw.io, but you still use it. Okay. Let me close this, and let's see if I can use this. Okay, so how to draw using draw.io, for example, it's easy. Just select and it will be here. You can stretch the, change the size. Okay. You can put a text engine. You can see, for example, change the style. You can change the size. You can have bold, italic, underline, strike through. You can change the color. Okay, things like that. Okay, so that's it. Okay. But since I'm familiar with Visio, I'll use Visio for the demonstration today. Okay. So that's it. That's the tools that you can use instead of using Visio. Okay. Since the university doesn't provide that many Visio licenses. Okay. Now, doesn't matter which one you use. You can use even there are other application as well that can draw a diagram. You can use it anytime you like, or any software that like you like. Doesn't matter. Why? Because when I give you assignment to draw a diagram, I will require you to save that diagram or to insert that diagram into Microsoft Word document. So for example, if you use draw.io, this one, you need to copy, you can just select this, copy, and then paste that into, say, PowerPoint. Oops, sorry. Oh, it's not. Okay, so it's not really a thing. Okay, but you can save this, for example. Apparently, I could not save this. For example, to
sir,
yeah. Your... Okay, sorry. Yeah. Thank you. I forget to share. Okay, so for example, using draw.io here, you just need to save this. Like I told you previously, bitmap to device, and save it, say, to the desktop. So, and you just need to insert that from storage. Where is it? Oh yeah, that's my mistake. Okay, so save it and there you go. You have the diagram. Okay, so regardless of the application you use for creating diagram, just save it as a picture, either with .jpg, JPEG, or PNG, or whatever, and then you can just insert it into any document. Okay. So in that regard, I don't really care what kind of diagramming tools that you will use, as long as you can save that as a picture and insert it into any application, either it's Microsoft Word, PowerPoint, or Excel, whatever, that's fine. Okay. The link that I provided to you, those two links, is just for reference. You can use that, but if you have any other alternative that's better for you, go for it. Okay, by all means. Okay, so that's okay. Let's start with the data flow diagram. Data flow diagram is a bit old technology. Okay. It has been around since the 60s and 70s, but we still teach that because it teaches you the logic of data. Okay, so data flow diagram, like its name, it show how data flowing from one place to another place, and it's also shown what happened or what process being done to that particular data. Okay. Now, drawing data flow diagram, it start with its the diagram called context diagram. So you cannot just create data flow diagram with plenty of symbols. No, you need to start from context diagram. It's similar to the way you create or write an article. You start with idea, which is the context diagram, and then you then expand that idea into main points, and then you develop and expand those main points into paragraphs, things like that. Okay, so start with context diagram. I'll show you after this. And there are two different process with Sorry, not two, two different diagram. Physical data flow diagram and logical data flow diagram. I'll show you later. Okay, and also there is flowchart. Okay, now there are only four symbols used for data flow diagram. This is circle, arrow, square or box, and two parallel line. Okay. There are other alternatives. Okay. This is this. I'm not good at it, but this is just I'm not good at it. Okay. Scratch that. Rather than misleading. Okay, so there will be. Okay, so this notation here, this symbol here, is called the DeMarco Jordan. Okay, so DeMarco Jordan. Like you already see, this is the DeMarco Jordan. I'll use this. Okay, so this is the DeMarco Jordan. So for process, the symbol is circle, or in this case, ellipse. The other notation is called Jean-Sarson. Okay, so with Jean-Sarson, for process or entity, it's using rounded corner square. Okay, for data storage, this is not right. So for data storage, in DeMarco Jordan, it's just two parallel line with Jean-Sarson is using open side square. Okay, so this is the source is similar. The arrow is also similar. So the difference is only for data storage and process, but the meaning are the same. How to draw it also the same. Okay, so there's no problem with it. In this particular case, I will use DeMarco Jordan. Okay, you can use either James Harden or DeMarco Jordan, as long as you are consistent. So, for example, for context diagram, you use DeMarco Jordan, and then if the next phase you use James Harden, that's not consistent. Okay. So what's the first step? Is to draw the context diagram. Okay. So first you draw the context. Okay. After that, it will go to what it's called level zero. Okay, zero. There are two level zero, which is logical and physical. Okay, and then if necessary, you can go to level one. Same, logical and physical. And if it's necessary, you can go to level two, also similar, logical and physical. So what's the difference between logical and physical data flow diagram or DFD? Physical will show the actor. Remember that in accounting information system, we will document it. The event, the economic event, the resources affected by the event, and the agent or the people or person or organization who involved in that event. So with physical, it show you the agent who or person or department or section or organization that involved with the system. With logical, it's showing you what are the data getting into. So what's the process being implemented to the data? Do you count the data? Do you store the data? Or do you erase the data, update the data, things like that, okay? Okay, so starting from context. Okay, this is a context diagram. The context diagram is just like the big picture of the whole data flow diagram. Okay, starting with, okay, so in data flow diagram, there are only three symbols being used. Okay, so remember, only three symbols being used. First is the circle or process. Second is the arrow. And third is the box or square. There is no data storage in context diagram. I know that some books showing or some practical module or some training module showing showing this here, that's a mistake. This is a big no-no. Okay. The storage are in here, inside the process, inside the system. Okay. If you have storage outside the system, it's just like you have your document cabinet being put on the street. Okay, so everybody can access it. It's not data storage are here inside the system. Okay, so that's it. Okay, let's start with sampling. When drawing a context diagram, you just had one circle representing what system you want to draw, and one or more box here or square representing external parties to the system. In this case, for example, in cash receipt process, customer is external, bank is also external. It happens to be in this example, customer and bank are parties outside the organization. But even parties within organization, like for example, sales department and manufacturing department, although they are the same department within although they are department within the same organization, in terms of data flow diagram, they are external to each other. Okay, so cash receipt process. Okay, so only one circle, one or minimum one box and circle, and also all the required arrow. Okay. Now, how to draw? So this is the context diagram. Customer make a payment, and then the payment will be deposited to the bank by the system. Okay, now remember, with data flow diagram is only the information that flowing. Payment here is the information about customer making a payment. Okay. In reality, customer probably make a direct deposit to the bank, you know, just deposited. Is it possible that customer doing this? Yes, it's possible. Okay. But it's not the concern of data flow diagram in context diagram. Okay. The concern of data flow diagram is how information flowing into the system and then flowing out to the from the system. Okay. Now, let me give you another example. Okay, let's draw a data flow diagram for class registration system. Okay, when you register for a class. Okay. So I'll draw this. Class registration system. You can still see the visual, right? Okay. So this is the class registration system. Now, let me ask one of you. Hey Joshua, David, Raposo.
Yes, sir.
Okay. You know what? I'm a bit uneasy with when you call me sir, because I'm not a member of British Empire, so I'm not being granted knighthood by the Queen Elizabeth. So, just call me Pak. Okay, it's more, and that's okay. So from now on, just call me Pak. Okay, yes, so okay, Faith, what by name I should call you? What's your?
You can call me Faith, sir.
Okay, good. So Faith, you can see the circle here, right? Class registration system.
Sir, yes.
Okay. In your opinion, who is the external parties to class or who involved with class registration system? Involved mean interact, sending something and will receive something information. Okay, they will send information and then they will also receive information. Okay, who involved with class registration system in your opinion? Just name one.
I think the students.
Okay, let me put it here. Students, good. Okay. Oops, there it is. Okay. Okay, students, good. Thank you. Let me see who else. Gladys, Nurlita Sari.
Yes.
Anybody else that involved with the system?
I think the university.
Okay, the university. Jonathan, Reginald?
Yes, sir.
Anybody else?
The lecturer.
Good. Okay. Okay, so then lastly, Eleonora, Michelle?
I don't know, sir.
Okay, you don't know. Okay. Okay, let me change the question. Do you think it's enough? Or is it?
Yes.
Okay, enough. Okay. You don't think it's too crowded? There are too many people or institution or person involved with this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, good. Now, the problem with data flow diagram and any other documentation, from one person, it could be different from the next person. Okay, I know that sucks. It means that you cannot have one single answer, and that's normal. Why? Because with the system, there are plenty of people or person or organization or institution that have some, what do you call it, agenda with the system. They have some need with the system. It's called the stakeholder of the system. Okay, so for example, customer will have different view compared to the management. The employee will have different view from the owner of the company. Okay, so that's normal. Okay, so and there is nothing wrong with this. Okay, it's in fact university involved with cash registration system, students involved obviously, and lecturer involved. But for the sake of simplicity, I will erase this. So. So there will be only two parties outside the system involved, which is students and lecturers. Okay. Now, so this is the component of a context diagram. Okay, the first diagram then. Okay. Is there anything that missed from this diagram? Maria Putri Bintang, is it done, complete, or is it miss anything?
I think it's done.
Okay. Pierre, what do you think?
The process.
Yeah, we have the process here, the circle. It's already here. Okay, good. Hildegard?
The cursor or maybe the lesson?
No. We will talk that later. Just focus on this. Remember the symbols for data flow diagram. Okay. So, is there anything miss from this picture?
I think it's enough, maybe.
Okay. What missing is the arrow. Okay. So, okay. Arrow into the system and out of the system. Okay, so let me just, I'll tell you why in a moment. Okay, so there should be, so this is following the system concept where you have input, So this is the input, the process, and the output. Okay. All the system in the world will have input, process, and output. Okay, so the arrow. Okay. Now, this is what actually happened. Okay. Okay. So the system will receive something, entered into the system, and it will send something out to the students. The student then will input something into the system, and then the classroom will have another output to the lecturers. Okay. Now, all the things that get into the system and also out of the system need to have name. Okay, so what do you enter to the system, class registration system? Any idea? What does students enter to the class registration system?
Payment?
No, no. Did you pay anything during class registration system? You pay after you finalize the class registration system. Okay? That's another process altogether. Anything else? Any idea? Have you ever actually enter your information into class registration system? I believe when you were become the students last semester, just before you enter it, you got this the explanation about this, right? Or demo, or I don't know, because of pandemic, it's really usually the new students will have a bit of training about this. Okay, so the students enter their preferred class. Okay, oops, oh, you know that. Okay, and in return they will have this is the study plan, or in bahasa it's called KRS. Okay. So you will have this. Okay. So the student will give preferred class, and if the preferred class accepted by the system, then you will get the study plan for KRS. If it's rejected, then you have to repeat the process to select another option. Okay. What's the lecturer provide here? Schedule. Okay, and what the lecturer got from here? Class list. Okay, so this is the context diagram. The lecturer will enter their preferred schedule, and then the student will select one of the schedule that suited their timeline or their planning or their preference. Then student will cut the study plan, KRS, and the lecturer will cut class list, the attendance list. Okay. Any questions so far? Can you follow my explanation? Okay. Okay. Now, let's continue. Anytime you're confused, just let me know. Okay. Okay, so that's the context diagram. And then, like I said, the second part after you have context diagram is you create another diagram that detail what happened inside here, inside the system. Okay, first is the physical level zero data flow diagram. So this is the physical level zero diagram. Okay. As you can see, there is data storage symbol here and here. Okay, so everything within the red line are represented by circle in the previous. So cash receipt process here, when you create a more detailed diagram, when you create diagram, what happened inside it, it will be like this. Okay. So when customer pay cash, for example, it will be accepted by sales clerk, and then it goes to cashier. Cashier will put that into computers and then deposit the cash. Okay, things like this. You may remember this, that there is one input here being processed and there is one output there. Okay, so it's always input, process, output. Okay. So everything that inside the red line representing cash receipt process here. Okay. Physical diagram showing who involved in a transaction. So who are involved in transaction? Sales clerk number one, computer number two, and cashier number three. There is no prescription or rules on giving the number. The number here is just for identification purposes. I can give the sales clerk 3.0, for example. I can give a computer 1.0, for example. It doesn't matter. Okay, as long as you are consistent. So it's just for identification purposes. Okay. So there are three process internally inside the cash receipt process. So that's for the physical data flow. This is for the logical. Okay, so everything inside the red line is the cash receipt process. And unlike the physical, you may see here that there are four circle or bubble. While the physical only had three, here there are four. So this circle in logical representing what are the process being done to the data entered into the system. So for example, payment from the customer. The payment will be received and then will be recorded and then compare cash and tape with sales data, prepare deposit, and then deposit it to the bank. So there are four circle here, while in the physical there are three circle. Okay. So far, you can follow me. Okay. So where did you find the circle? Where did you find the arrow and things like that? How many circles there are? How many data stories there are? I'll explain to you later. It's part of the course today. Okay. So data flow diagram should be balanced. It means when you have input, it should have output. Let's take this for example. So this is the source of data. There are A data flowing into the system and there are B data coming out of the system to the destination. So this is the context diagram. Okay. And then when you create level zero, you can see that A and B are still there. Okay, remember this, A, B. It means A is the input, B is the output. Okay, so here again, A and B. It means balance. Okay, so apparently inside the system, there are C and D. Okay, so when you want to make, say for example, this circle number 1.0 more details, you have to remember what data going into 1.0, which is A, and what data are coming out of 1.0, C and D. So when you create more detail, which is the level one, you'll have this. Okay, so remember, this is have 1.0. If you want to make more detailed diagram about 1.0, then it would be here, 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, 1.4. Okay, and remember, what data coming into the system? A. There is A here. And what data coming out of the system? C and D. And that's called balance. Okay. Now, where do you know how many circles, how many data flow, how many data storage, things like that? That's where you remember that I told you the first that documentation of system is called narrative description. That's the source. Okay, so this is the process when you want to documenting a system. First, you need to observe the system. That's why I prepare you with you select one company and you pick their main business. For example, the companies like Gojek and Tokopedia, they provided many services, but later on, just pick one. Okay, pick the main process that you want to observe. Okay, Gojek, for example, you can observe either the go right part, go food part, or whatever. Okay, just pick one. Okay, you may pick a lot, but it will make your life complicated. So I just want to make your life simpler. Okay, so pick one. Okay, so and then what happened? You need to observe completely and document it that in a narrative form. So you tell a story. Okay, you describe the process as detailed as possible. Remember, there are three things that you need to document. One, what's the effect on what the process? Second, the resources affected by the event. Third, the agent or person involved with that process. Okay. Now I will add something to the three things that you. You also need to describe what the roles of each person. For example, let's see this. Okay, who received the payment? Who record sales? Who compare cash and sales data? And who prepared the deposit? Okay, you probably see sales clerk, computer, and cashier. Okay, so who? This is will be the agent. The process that will be receive payment, record sale, compare cash, and take with sales data and prepare deposit. Okay, so that's how would I approach that. And then when you have the agent, you have to identify whether that agent that involved with the system are internal or external to the system. Okay, with external here, the external parties to the system, they only had one function, which is either sending or receiving information, nothing else. Okay. Receiving or sending. But with the internal, they can sending, receiving, and then create a lot of other things. But this and this, they only send and receive, nothing else. Okay. So yeah, that says how. So go. All the external will be represented by square, and then all the internal will be circle. Okay. Any question so far? I know that is a bit confusing perhaps, but my suggestion is, and I will do this with your assignment, we'll go step by step. OK, okay, rather than rush into something, we will go step by step. Okay. Okay, so for your next assignment, okay, for your next assignment, this is here. Okay, we start with description. Okay, so in the online community that your group observe, please pick one major business process, like I said, from their main business. Describe in detail at all the steps or stages of that process from start until finish. Do not forget to include event, the process, resources affected by the event, and agents involved, including roles and action of each agent. Okay, so this is where you observe the process. Okay, make the description as detailed as possible. Okay, and this is not an easy task, and most likely you will not get complete description on your first try. Okay. That's why the real system analyst, when you work as a system analyst in the field, in practice, they will spend times to observe. Okay, let me show you this example. So this is the from the project that I did with the Ministry of Home Affairs many years ago, almost 7 years ago, more than 7 years ago, sorry. Okay. So, for example, this is the report about the analysis of the system. It's the program itself is no longer exists. National Power Program for Community Empowerment (PNPM). This is from the PNPM Perdesaan. This program is belong to Pak Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono as president. Pak Jokowi replaced that with village program desa. So this is what they did. This is actually a survey throughout Indonesia. So this is the place that they survey. Yogyakarta, East Java, Banten, Lampung, North Sumatra, Central Kalimantan, West Kalimantan, South Sulawesi, North Sulawesi, Papua, North Maluku, and East Nusa Tenggara. Okay, NTT. So you can see that this team went to these 12 provinces all over Indonesia to get, you know, to observe how the process, because this is a national program. Even though in Jakarta you already described, so you need to do this, this, and this, but the implementation of that process on the province level or on the regency level or the village level could be quite different, because let's face it, Jakarta different from Central Kalimantan. You know, in Jakarta or in Jogja probably we can use internet quite easily, but in the middle of jungle of Kalimantan, that's not the case. Okay, I've been to Kalimantan in the any of you came from Kalimantan? No? Okay, I went to Kalimantan and went to the, well, you know, the last civilization before the mining area. So whenever people want to go to the coal mines, they will stay in this small city for a few weeks, and then they go to the my youngest brother used to do that. So whenever he wanted to go to the mine site, on the last town, he'll send us message and saying that I'll go to the mines and I will not be able to be contacted for a month, for example. So that's the last, you call it last realization. Okay, and it's very hard to get a good cellular reception. Okay, I would be lucky to be able to send text message. It's probably better now, but it's 7 years ago. Anyway, so that's the survey. They go to 12 provinces and they spend weeks on each provinces to observe. So what I was trying to say to you is, if you cannot get detailed observation on the first try, don't worry. Okay. Even seasonal system analysts will have difficulties to do that. Okay, so that's normal. Okay, so that's the assignment for next week. Okay, and then we will try to draw data flow diagram from there. Okay, so you decided you describe the process as detailed as possible, and then we will try to draw data flow diagram from there. Any question? Okay, we still have one more things left, which is the flow chart. Okay. Flow chart, it's even older than data flow diagram, but while data flow diagram is no longer being popular now, it's been replaced by another. Flow chart is still popular. Why? Because flow chart will show step by step procedure. If you look at data flow diagram, like this one. In data flow diagram, there is no sequence. We can put number one here, number two here, number three here, number four here, but it's not necessarily mean number one should be done before number two, three, or four. No, it's just a number for identification. It's not showing the sequence. It's not showing which has to be done first. Okay. With flowchart, you need to show what process being done first, and it's follow input process output again. Okay. Unfortunately, with flowchart there are plenty of symbols, as you can see here in Visio. This is basic flowchart shape. As you can see, there are plenty of other shapes or template in Visio. So there are plenty of it. With data flow diagram, you only need to conserve with four. Here, more than four, obviously. But don't worry. Okay, at least in my class, if you have exam and I ask you to draw a flow chart, I will provide you with a template of flow chart. So you don't have to remember. You don't have to remember what this symbol mean, what this symbol means, things like that. Okay. So if you look at flowchart symbols, it's obvious that this came from era when the computer was first being developed and used. For example, CRT display. CRT display is a tube display, you know, the huge TV of the old days. I don't know whether you still remember or not. Okay. Disk, it's either hard drive. Why they use a cylindrical shape for this? Because this were used to be cylindrical. Nowadays, if we prefer to disk or storage, it's box, you know, just like flash disk or thing like that. Tape, they use still tape. We didn't use tape anymore now. Okay, don't use it now. Punch card. Even I, when I was studying computers in early 90s, I didn't use punch card either. It's very old technology. So this is flowchart. Okay. So there is input symbols, process symbols, and output symbols, and also data storage connectors and other connectors. Okay. So how to draw flowchart? First, you need to identify the agent again. Okay. Who involved? Okay. And then just draw step by step using the appropriate symbol. For example, customer, or in this case, clerk input document. So clerk will, you need to draw the document and then give the name. Key input using this symbol to the computer. So this is the computer part and this is the clerk part. Things like that. Okay, so just follow that and use the appropriate symbols. Okay, the source of that drawing process in flowchart is came from description, the narrative documentation that you will make for next week. So for next week, for the practice, we will have a flowchart drawing and also data flow diagram drawing. Okay. Any question? So if you're still confused about that, that's fine. Okay, we will hopefully next week we can resolve that. Okay, so we will have practice on how to draw data flow diagram and flowchart. Okay. Okay, that's it for today. Thank you for attending the class and see you next week.